Hi guys, Harry here. Welcome to Scrap Science. Okay, hydrochloric acid, as we have here, and as you probably know, is a very, very useful chemical. It is by far the cheapest mineral acid I can get hold of. I get it from my local hardware store. I think it says here as 32% hydrochloric acid as a solution in water, and it's always handy to have around. There is, however, one issue with the hydrochloric acid that I get from the hardware store, and that is the fact that it contains some impurities in there. People tell me that there's iron in solution, which gives it a slight yellow color, which we will have a look at later. And additionally, I've found that this particular brand of hydrochloric acid that I can get has some kind of redox active species in solution as well. I've noticed that adding strong oxidizers to the solution turns the solution a vibrant red, and similarly adding strong reducing agents to the solution will turn the solution a strong purple. Now, for the vast majority of experiments, this isn't an issue at all, but for the rare occasion where the impurities that we have in here do actually pose an issue, I think it'll be nice to have just a small amount of purified hydrochloric acid without any of the iron or any of the other impurities that are in solution with it. Luckily for us, there is one very easy method to purify this impure hydrochloric acid, and that is distillation. So that's what we're going to be doing today. We'll distill some hydrochloric acid to purify it and save it for later use when we don't want to have any contamination at all. The one downside to distilled hydrochloric acid is that the azeotrope of hydrochloric acid and water is about a 20% concentrated solution of hydrochloric acid. So as we boil our azeotrope, the distilled product that we're going to get is going to be quite significantly diluted compared to our concentrated 32% hydrochloric acid that we get here. But I think that's a pretty fair trade-off for purity. So my plan is to make 500 milliliters of this purified hydrochloric acid. And the first step in doing that is to just dilute it to the azeotrope. So all we need is a beaker. And then first of all, we need about 275 milliliters of concentrated hydrochloric acid. That should be enough. It's not particularly significant. I'm not sure whether it comes through on camera, but you can see a slight yellow tinge to the solution here, which will hopefully be removed once we've distilled it. Anyway, then I'm just going to top it up to 500 milliliters with distilled water. Not that this water actually needs to be distilled, seeing as we're about to distill it anyway, but that's what I'm going to do. And there we are. That should be about the concentration of the azeotrope ready to distill. If it's not exactly the right concentration, it shouldn't pose too big of an issue. And now, ta-da, I have our distillation apparatus all set up. Couldn't really be much simpler than this. We have our heating mantle containing our hydrochloric acid solution, which is about the azeotrope concentration that will boil off. We have our distillation set up with a condenser ready to condense all of the hydrochloric acid that we boil. We have our receiving flask. This shouldn't be too hard to do because the azeotrope of hydrochloric acid and water boils at about 108 degrees, which is certainly not a difficult temperature to reach. And then just in case our concentration isn't right, or we inevitably generate hydrogen chloride fumes, I have a trap for any hydrogen chloride gases that come through. This is just a beaker full of a small amount of sodium hydroxide solution, which will absorb any acidic gases. You can see I've also set up this beaker with an inverted funnel to blow the gases through. That is to prevent any suckback, which I think is perfectly possible. As a final note, I have sealed all of the joints in this apparatus with a bit of PTFE tape. That's just what I tend to do when we're dealing with boiling acids, and it seems to work very well. So all up, we are ready to distill our acid. I'll turn on the heating mantle and get our water circulating through the condenser. And it's just starting to boil now, so if we are able to have a look over here, we should get something condensing in our condenser soon. first drops coming over now. Our gas scrubber's doing something. Suppose it's working. Anyway, the procedure from here on is pretty simple. We just continue heating our boiling flask, continue boiling our hydrochloric acid solution until we have filled up our receiving flask with our now purified hydrochloric acid. Really doesn't look like it'll take that long, so that's nice. Well, that was pretty easy, honestly. You can see we have distilled over those 250 milliliters of acid, all of the impurities. It kind of looks a bit yellow and turbid in there, along with something that has crystallized out on the walls of the boiling flask. All of our impurities should be in there, as I said, and all of our purified acid should be over here. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to let the whole apparatus cool down. I will take out our now purified acid, and then I'll just put in the next 250 milliliters, which I still have in this beaker here, and we will distill that over and we'll be done. Honestly, this was probably one of the most tame distillations I've ever done. There were no problems with bumping, no problems with speed. I mean, it went really fast, and we got our 250 milliliters of acid very quickly. No issues with suck back either, so that's good too. Round two, we're ready to go once again, so I'll turn the heating mantle on. You can see our solution is quite cloudy now that we have concentrated the impurities from the previous batch. But once we've finished distilling over this 250 milliliters, I've emptied out the receiving flask. Once we've got that, we will have finished. And there we are. We have finished our second distillation of the hydrochloric acid. And you know, ignoring the fact that we are genuinely boiling an aggressive acid, this was a really nice distillation, I'd say. Doing it for a second time, I will say again that it was really fast, it was really nice, and we didn't even get any suck back from our gas scrubber there. So really, one of the easier distillations I've done. We have all of our impurities in the boiling flask remaining there. They look very yellow right now, which is to be expected from the iron, I suppose. And in the receiving flask, our nice, clean, purified acid. Again, I'm just going to let the apparatus cool down, then I'll take it apart and collect all of the purified acid that we made. With the impurities, they should all still be soluble in water, so it shouldn't be too hard to clean it up. And I don't expect any of the contaminants to be particularly dangerous because this hydrochloric acid is sold as a pool chemical, so it can't be that bad. While it's cooling down, I thought I'd better show you that we have actually purified the acid here. So what I've done is I have got a few milliliters of our purified acid on the left here and a few milliliters of the original hardware store hydrochloric acid. And what I'm going to do is add a small amount of 3% hydrogen peroxide. In the past, I've noticed that adding a small amount of hydrogen peroxide to this acid will produce a red color. As I said at the start of the video, it's a strong oxidizer and produces a strong red color. So hopefully we have removed whatever contaminant is in there that causes that to happen. So I'll just show you the red color that occurs there. Very obvious, very strong. And then in our purified stuff, no color change at all. Excellent. That is exactly what I wanted to see. As a final note on storage, I am storing our purified acid now in this glass chemical bottle because it looks nice. It's very much overkill though. I mean, quite a few plastic bottles will hold concentrated hydrochloric acid just fine. I mean, it comes in a plastic bottle from the hardware store, so it'll do perfectly fine. But anyway, there we have it. 500 milliliters roundabout of crystal clear hydrochloric acid purified from the stuff we get at the hardware store. These volume readings are wildly inaccurate, I've found, so don't listen to those. It is nice to have something simple that actually works for a change on this channel, so I'm very happy with this. I'm also in the middle of doing my lithium extraction from lithium ion batteries, and I tell you what, that has given me a few headaches lately, so this is extra nice to have this small success. But anyway, you'll see all the strife I've been having with my lithium extraction in my next video, so hopefully I'll see you then.